Okay, we're on the air.
We're on
the air. We're on the air, and a live TV show.
Welcome
on
back.
The air. And I'm going to, right away, I'm going to introduce my co-host of all these years, my journalistic partner for almost 7 years, the ebullient, vivacious, amazing Tara Jean Vitale.
Thank you very much.
McDonald.
And McDonald Vitale.
McDonald, okay.
And I want to introduce Calvin Schwartz, the man of the hour, the man with the red hat. The ever-ready bunny keeps on going.
Yes.
Calvin going. Schwartz. So welcome to the show, everybody. Welcome back.
Do your teaser.
Oh, yes. So tonight's going to be really special because we have, and I wrote this down, but we have an HBO filmmaker, a Disney actor, a comic book writer, number one on Amazon, and a singer-actress from New Jersey, Oklahoma, New York to Virginia. So that's what you're in store for tonight. Boom.
Is
that it?
Okay, we did a teaser. We've been talking about doing a teaser for a long time because
mm-hmm.
we want to grab everybody and hold on to them.
Keep people in.
Yes, so this was great stuff. So now I'm going to do a little bit of a monologue that I've been rehearsing all day because this is important stuff. I'm looking at everybody. First, I want to acknowledge our studio guests. We don't have a lot of studio guests, but I'd like to acknowledge Hunter from Virginia. And then, very importantly, Morgan Sanguidolce from Rutgers University. Morgan used to intern for NJ Discover when we were doing Sky Blue professional soccer. And what so impressed me about Morgan is she is studying theater and film. And she did a film called Woman, W-O-M-A-N, Under the Veil. And she won two awards for that. And it's a story about a Muslim woman wearing a hijab. And it just impressed me, and it just kind of blew me away. By the way, everybody can find that film, Woman Under the Veil, on YouTube, and you really should see it. And those two awards, one of them is taking her to Cannes, upcoming in Cannes. So really, really exciting. I saw the film. Actually, I watched it twice, and it's wonderful. So welcome, Morgan. And then to Joel Potter. It's actually Joel Potter who it was the matchmaker. I'm looking at you, John. Who was the matchmaker who put all of us together when he introduced me to John and all the chemistry and all the synchronicity unfolded. And that's how this show was born, actually, last April. So it took some time to implement, but here we all gathered together.
Yeah, that's a long time, actually.
Yes. So that's the show. And I also love to thank some of the folks who helped broadcast our show, meaning Kevin Seary, who started the ball rolling from Long Branch Cablevision. I also want to thank Rutgers University TV because they now, of course, they carry our show, and they've actually been advertising our show to the student body, which is great. Also, Old Bridge Cablevision, Princeton TV, which carries our show. And I'm always very, very proud to say that if you add all these potential cable subscribers, we've got 500,000.
Yeah.
Out there in television land, which is very impressive.
Yeah.
And that's what we've done. So the show is entitled A Night of Entertainment because we have such a wide variety of entertainment people here beyond. But it also could have been also called All My Children.
Why? Oh.
Well, but we're going to leave it at that. We're going to leave it at that. Let's be cryptic. So leave that at that. So I'm just going to do a couple of things. I love to say that I'm on the advisory board. I think I mentioned this last time, but I'm on the advisory board of the New Jersey Digital Newspaper Project. And what they do, they're going to take 100,000 pages of old newspapers, really interesting stuff, and they're going to digitalize it and have that old information. And for all the powers that be, they asked me to sit on this advisory board, which is made up of newspaper owners and a slew of PhDs and a couple of journalists, myself included. So it's a great experience. It exposes me to a whole new world at Rutgers Library and looking at the Rutgers folks here. And I've been hanging out with the head of Rutgers Library. So it's been a very interesting project. And folks can find it if you want to Google it, New Jersey Digital Newspaper Project. It's really part of the Library of Congress, and every state is doing this to save part of our heritage.
Yeah, so you'll be able to search back to any time in the year and
going in
the
1800s, 1900s,
and read a newspaper that was printed.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yes. Not all newspapers, but they select certain key areas in the state. So the one they've been doing now is Perth Amboy. And it was so great because I went to this event they had last week,
great.
And they and this is 1900, and they had a picture of a house, and in the house in all the different rooms they had this house sells sheets, and this house sells books, and this house sells water. In other words, in each part of this house, and it was an advertisement in a newspaper from 1900. But then I looked at it and I said, oh my God, it's Amazon. I mean, my goodness,
yeah.
It's oh wow, it's like an Amazon ad from 1900. Really interesting stuff. So that's number one. Number two, I must say that last night I hung out, this is right up your alley. I hung out and spent 5 or 6 hours with Dennis Moleyton from the Phoenix Suns and the New York Knicks and Weequake High School in USC. Yes. And boy, did he fill my head, and I'm looking right at you, John. Did he fill my head with some really inside things, which means there's a book, there's an article, which I'm going to do on the life of Mo Layton, some of the stories he told me. I didn't even tell you about that. It's really great. Next up, I want to thank Brianna Eve for turning me on to Central Casting, because for 3 weeks I was almost a contender, and for 3 weeks I was being considered to be a body double for Benicio del Toro in a film that they're making in upstate.
Wow.
And Ben Stiller is a director. So for 3 weeks, I was somebody. And then it disappeared. So be it. I didn't want to go to upstate New York for 6 weeks anyway. It's too cold. Next thing I wanted to say, and I'm almost done, I've been telling you for like a year I'm going to start writing a novel.
Yeah.
And I have. And you all are going to be in it. It's kind of fictional memoir, and I started writing it a month ago, and I'm really banging it out. It's great. I haven't done a novel in 10 years. It's time. And finally, my last segment: things that scare the hell out of me. And
so
this
much
I
fun.
Always do.
I like to hear about this.
Yeah, this is our president, whose name escapes me, is going to open up all the Atlantic Ocean for ocean drilling, so no more restrictions. And thing that scares the hell out of me is if they start drilling off the coast of New Jersey, all they got to do when they're doing all this drilling is just spill 1 gallon of oil, which ain't much, and it will pollute 1 million gallons of water. And I'm done.
That's scary.
And I'm done.
Oh, Tara, my goodness.
Take it away.
What? Well, I would rather talk about the new year. It's the new year, and bucket lists. And so I had, the past few years, I've had some nice bucket lists, because I this past year I got the opportunity to ride a mechanical bull, which was on my bucket list.
Wow.
That was really fun. I have it on video, and I don't think I'm going to post it on social media because it was really funny. But that was one of my things from last year. So this year, I'm going back and forth between a couple of things, but one of my biggest bucket list things is to go to London, to stand on the moors, to gather the heather, and to yell out for Heathcliff.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Because that's that movie.
Yes, Wuthering Heights.
So, and my daughter did go to London, and I asked her to do that for me, so I don't know if she actually did it. She did. She's over there. All right, so that's all I want to talk about, New Year's resolutions and bucket lists. So
wonderful.
I think we can get into the show
now. So first up, to introduce John Hulme, who has so much on his resume, and the best part of it is John was brought to me by Joel back in April, and we sat down and we went through the discovery process, and the things that you've done just kind of blew me away, especially the HBO movie, which I sat and I watched. The story about your dad in Vietnam and taking your mother back there just kind of blew me away, because I came out of that Vietnam era and I'm very sensitive to that. And all your other projects, and because I really wanted to get into, I went to see Blacked Out, which we can get to talk about.
Sure.
So anyway, I'm thrilled that you're here, John.
That's a huge honor. Especially since we come from the same Weequake hierarchy.
Right.
You know?
I should say, John and I meet for the first time, and he kind of mentions, and this is amazing. It's such a synchronistic thing. He kind of mentions his mom's name, maiden name. It's Ellen Bratter. And then I just randomly say, oh, back in, I hate to say this, 1959, it pains me. 1959, I went to high school, and there was an all-city football player named Warren Bratter. And he says, it's my uncle.
My Uncle Warren.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that crazy?
Whom I met.
It seems like everybody went to Weequake around
well,
that
Well, a lot.
Generation.
It is. Listen, it is. So, why don't you take it away and start with John?
We have
the introduction.
Yeah, we have the introduction. So you are a filmmaker writer. Mm-hmm. You've done so many films. And so at what point did you realize this is where you're going to go with your life?
I mean, I think from a very young age, I can remember being like 3 or 4 years old and like sitting under a table and coming up with ideas for stories and movies and writing. But really never wrote or filmed anything until after college, and I think a lot of that had to do with I always struggled with believing in myself. I always felt like the ideas were great here, but anytime I would take it out and put it on the table, it wouldn't live up to what I imagined. So I was always sort of scared to do that, and I happened to get lucky and bumped into a friend of mine that I'd gone to high school with right after college. He'd gone to Princeton, Michael Wexler, and he was the opposite of me. He didn't have a lot of ideas, but he was totally sure that he was destined for great things and had all the confidence that I didn't have. So the two of us joined together, started working together, and we published our first book together called Voices of the Exiled, which was a collection of short stories that we edited. And we worked together for 10, 15 years. So he really kind of got me over the hump of how hard it was to, imagine yourself a creative person and then becoming one.
Wow. So now, at what point did you do this film called Searching for a Father?
Unknown Soldier Searching for a Father?
Yeah.
That was later on in my, I want to say, started shooting it or came up with the idea in like 1999, 2000. My father had been killed in Vietnam before I ever met him. I was about 3 weeks old. And I grew up kind of knowing nothing about him. Mostly because, as far as I was concerned, it wasn't like a loss of father. I just never had one in the first place. And when I hit around 29, 30 years old, I met my wife, and I realized it was no longer okay that I couldn't tell you how he died, what he was like. Was it weird that he was Catholic and my mom was Jewish? And so I decided to start tracking down everybody that knew him, childhood friends, college buddies, all the guys that served with him in the war. In that process, I found the man who had tried to give him mouth-to-mouth as he was dying, told me exactly where it happened. Yeah, Sergeant Richard Haynes was his name. He lived in Colorado, Gunnison, Colorado. That was the only time they ever met. And he told me where it happened, and so I reached out to my mom. This is also the first time I really spoke to my mom about what it was like to lose him, which was an incredibly difficult, painful, but, inspiring conversation at the same time. And she told me that it was always her dream to go back to Vietnam. So I took my cameraman, Bo Webb, who I met in North Carolina, and his wife and my producer, and we all took my mom back to Vietnam, retraced my father's steps from Saigon up to Quang Tri in the DMZ, and found the place where he was killed and had a second funeral for him.
Wow.
And I was able to kind of, as a little boy, I was always sort of like immune to the grief that my mom was going through. It was all over my head. I thought I had a great childhood, raised by my grandparents too. So to see her, the transformation that took place when she had this funeral for him at Vandegrift Air Base in the mountains of Vietnam, it was like you can see it in the movie, she was like 20 years younger after it. And it was a wonderful experience and to give that to her. So, and then it was, even better when HBO decided to buy the film and put it on air, and I was able to show it, especially to Vietnam veterans and their families.
How did HBO find the film?
It was really a weird serendipitous thing. I had a lawyer friend who went to a college with Nancy Abraham, who was an executive in HBO documentaries, and she put it on her desk, and that's where it sat for about 6 months, because this was the kind of movie where if I told you about it in a bar or on the street, you'd say, oh, I really want to see that, but you also know that it's going to be intensely emotional material. So it's never that. Today's never the day for that, right?
Right.
And finally she watched it, And, you know, after probably out of guilt, you know, that I, oh my God, I got to watch that movie. And then they bought it the next day. That was a really awesome experience.
It was such an amazing movie, and everybody really has to watch this movie. And they can see this how?
Now, so the rights reverted back to me, and right now I'm actually looking for somewhere else to show it because, I show it a lot at Rutgers. I show it a lot at the Vietnam class.
I have it on.
What's that?
Can you put it?
Well, I did. I aired it. I put it in film festivals when it came out, and we went. The best part about that was being up in Providence, Rhode Island, where my father was from, and showing it to all the people that he grew up with, and it was incredibly powerful. And all the Vietnam vets were in the movie came, and it was really the first time any of these guys had spoken about their experiences with their wives or children. We got to do it right in front of us. And the funny thing about that is there was a lot of times you think it's going to be really sad stories they're telling, but most of it was like the good times they had in Vietnam that they were able to share with their loved ones for the first time. It was a really powerful experience.
And the footage, where did you get and how did you get all that footage?
The old stuff or the new stuff? So
the
United States Marine Corps really came through for us.
Really?
I called them up, told them where my father was stationed. They said, we have some stuff. I drove down there. And the best part was there was a guy who had served right in the same area who had brought like a Super 8 camera with him. And basically he was living in the same place, driving up down the same roads.
Yeah.
So that when we went there, if you see the movie, you can see we're driving down the same roads as this guy.
Same and I mountains in the back.
The nice thing was I was able to track him down to Pennsylvania, and I called him up and I said, "Hey, man, can I use your Super 8 footage?" And he was so thrilled to get that call.
Yeah.
So really, when you're on that kind of project, what's so life affirming about it is everybody comes out of the woodwork to try to help you, and that went all the way back, to the Vietnamese people themselves who went. They, at that time especially. There was no mystery when an American family comes to Vietnam why they're there. And the people were just so kind to us and took us to where we needed to go and really looked out for my mom too, because they could tell that she was wrestling with something.
Post your film, did you take in Ken Burns' History of Vietnam?
No, sometimes I just find out a little too maddening for the reasons you have. It's a really hard thing to find out that like Henry Kissinger could have stopped the war before my father was dead, right? That was a real painful thing to find out. And so, this was a very healing experience for my family making this film and all the things that I went through, and I felt like I completed something. Mm-hmm. And to go revisit Vietnam too much has been really hard for me.
And I think it was something that was complete for you, and you really had a lot of emotional attachment and closure with it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think your story is thousands and thousands of people's stories. Well, same story.
It's true, and it's become more poignant as we've gone to war. Like, when we started making this movie, the idea that we would be in war for a generation was inconceivable, right? We were still bearing what was happening from Vietnam. So, it was a really heavy experience. The first time I got invited by the Vietnam Vets Association to come down and show it in D.C. and talk at the wall. And there were all these young 18-year-old kids that had come back from Iraq and Afghanistan, damaged. And I was like, I can't believe how young these people are. How could they send people that young into, and the fact that they had gone through that. And I think that the movie sort of takes on new meaning. That's one of the things I'm most proud of as we go through this experience of being at war. You see it through a different prism as when I first set out to do it.
Okay, amazing job.
I'm going to jump.
Yes, sure. Jump.
I'm jumping. Jump out. 6-7 weeks ago, I went to see Blacked Out, which just blew me away. Can you tell the story of Blacked Out?
Yeah, sure. So a few months ago, maybe about 6 months ago, I was approached by a group in Highland Park. I'm from Highland Park. And a group there called Parents of Students of Color reached out to me and said, "Hey, would you be interested in making a documentary project about the oral history of the town's black community, which has been a bedrock of the town since the early 1900s. And I said, "Yeah, that would be awesome, but I think it would be better if, what if we took kids from the high school, I taught them how to operate the equipment and how to conduct an interview and brought them into people's homes so that not only would we capture the oral history of the community, but the community would come together as part of that, people learning their own history." So most of that was focused on interviewing the town elders of that community, and it was really going well. And in the process of that, out of nowhere, somebody came up to me and said, listen, I was in Irving School, which is the town's primary school. And at Irving School, every kid who's ever graduated there, and when I say graduated, like gone from second grade to third grade, before they leave, they make this porcelain tile, and it goes up on the wall like this mosaic, and it's been going on from the 60s. And it's something that's very personal and powerful for every kid that's ever gone through this school system from that time. And somebody said, listen, there, I found a tile from 1979 that is really, really disturbing. It's been hanging up there for 40 years, and I don't know who did it, but we painted it over black because we can't have our kids see it. And so I'm not, the reason I'm not telling you what it, what's on there is because I'm hoping, I don't want to spoil the surprise, but it's a very disturbing image with racial connotations, and it's a, you know, it's the kind of thing that I've walked past a million times because both of my kids went to that school and I never noticed it. Wow. So what I decided to do was take all my kids that I'm working with, which is about 20 students, and we decided to solve the mystery of who did it, what teacher put it up there, who said it was okay to hang this, why has it hung there for 40 years.
Has that been solved?
Well, not entirely.
Okay.
I reached out to the person whose name was on that, okay, and he had no memory of doing it,
okay,
and said that it wasn't me. And I felt like, you know, it was a weird thing, obviously, to be, to be contacted out of the blue 40 years later, to be then confronted with this thing you might have done as a 9 or 10 year old kid. And I think that our, from the, what I tried to tell him and what the film comes from, no, a place of no judgment, right? You're, who's going to judge a 9 or 10 year old kid for what they did? I think we're looking at what is it, you know, what were the adults thinking at that time? And what does it say about, you know, our history as a town? Highland Park likes to think of itself as a very liberal, progressive, diverse community, and it is those things. But there's also skeletons in its closet, and that's the kind of thing that we've unearthed while making this movie. And so it was a really amazing experience when Cal, at the screening Cal was talking about, which was sort of like a private Highland Park only screening, to have these kids up there in dialogue with, you know, current day children in dialogue with people
wonderful.
Who've lived Highland Park all their lives about race and about who we are as a town.
It was wonderful. It was really standing room only.
Yeah,
which
pretty awesome.
Was so impressed me.
And my kids were amazing.
I think this is next because we're gonna kind of move on.
Your dream project.
Yes.
Oh,
yes,
yeah, no. We were just talking about
yeah,
that.
I know. That's why I wanted to get that
my
in.
My dream project. So I grew up as a child, huge fan of horror movies. Always wanted to make a horror movie. And so I decided to write something that I could shoot right there in Highland Park, around locations in Highland Park. And when I was a kid, that same time when I was sitting under tables coming up with movies, I had this series of terrible recurring nightmares. Every night, like a boogeyman figure would sneak into my bedroom and stuff me into its sack and kind of take me away. And I'd wake up screaming for help. And basically, my mom, you know, took me to a therapist, and I never had these dreams again for 25 years until my son was born. And suddenly they came back exactly the same, except this boogeyman character wasn't coming after me anymore. He was coming after my son. And so I was freaking out when it was happening because it all felt like it was really happening. And so I decided to write a script about that,
wow,
autobiographical experience. Wow. And, you know, so I wrote that. I've been trying to get the financing for that for several years now. I'm feel like I'm closer than I've ever been before. I'm with a really great company that's feels really supportive behind it. And so, you know, I've never done anything like this, but that
wonderful.
There's no doubt that's my dream project.
Excellent.
One quick question.
Yes.
And then we're going to move on to Mr. Neil. Who's your favorite director?
My favorite director? You know, there's a woman named Andrea Arnold who has, find really inspiring.
Okay.
She made a movie last year that came out called American Honey.
Okay.
She made a really amazing adaptation of Wuthering Heights, which you should see.
Oh, wow.
Which feels like it is not dated at all.
Wow.
It's a totally different thing.
Yeah.
It's about a Heathcliff that's
it.
Black, and it's
wow.
But it's so vibrant. She also made this amazing movie called Fish Tank, which
okay.
blew
me
away.
We'll talk more about her later.
Yes.
Next up, Neil.
Neil Schwartz.
Neil Schwartz. So I guess I should introduce you.
Yes. I guess.
We don't even talk about nepotism, but it's particularly thrilling for me to bring you on and sit across a table from you. And
well, it's an honor to be here. Well, finally.
Really. I've been trying to do this for a long time to come up with, you know, a reason to believe and a cause and to bring you here because you have, especially now with everything going on, it's just hugely appropriate. So, first question, why don't you just talk about your bio, your background, education, and how you wound up in this comic book world?
Sure. Well, I mean, Marlboro, home born and raised, I guess. I went through college, and I've always been a huge comic book fan, starting from like a young age. And it always spoke to me, and I actually can say that one of my oldest friends, who we've kind of lost a little bit of contact with, was the one who introduced me. And in the back of my mind, I always had this calling to write comics or actually write movies. I actually have some scripts that I wrote when I was a lot younger of doing like the Avengers before they did everything now, which is, you know, I haven't read back, but I'm sure it's not nearly as good as they have now. But you know, I was always just drawn to that medium, and I kind of kept that in my head, even going through high school and whatnot. I never really thought that I would have this real opportunity to actually jump into comics because, like working in movies, it's very selective. There's so many people who are so involved, and I always kind of kept this little bit of passion in the back of my head. And you know, even my parents gave me this great motivation. You know, you can always aspire, but also, you know, you should still have something tangible. So when I went to college, I focused on business school, and through one of the internships that I had, I was very fortunate to get a job for this company called Dable Brothers Publishing, which kind of ties in because working at that job, I met my brother for life, Derek Ruiz, who I guess I'm hoping is actually watching right now. and him and I built up this wonderful, wonderful relationship, and he brought me into this anthology. What we're essentially doing is an anthology about Puerto Rico to raise money for Puerto Rico. And you know, you not being a Puerto Rican, it's very hard. We're working with so many different like Puerto Rican writers and artists. Everyone who feels so impacted by what happened with the hurricane. So many people not having power, not having the supplies, not having the medical needs that they can get. So what we're trying to do through this anthology called Puerto Rico Strong is raise money where all the proceeds outside of production costs will actually go to Puerto Rico.
Okay, great. So you've actually created a comic book.
We have. So it will be coming out in March. I believe it's going to be around 196 pages. There's still some wiggle room. I mean, we have a little bit of time, but yeah, so I'm a co-editor on this project amongst a few others. This guy, Marco Lopez, who I hope is also watching, this was his brainchild. He brought in this woman, Desiree, he brought in Derek, and then through Derek, I was brought in.
Able to actually write some of it.
Yes, I did. So this is actually my first. So there are a lot of writers. I am one of the writers who's writing a 10-page story called Hope. It's about a father bringing his son to Puerto Rico to try and find the spirit mm-hmm. of Puerto Rico, to have an identity of Puerto Rico and being a Puerto Rican and what that means, because a lot of people, you know, and actually we were talking about this before. In schools, we don't talk about Puerto Rico. We don't learn about the Puerto Rican heritage. We don't learn, and they're a part of America. They're not a state, but you know, they are a part of us. And seeing how we are treating them in this horrible time is just atrocious. So I wrote this 10-page story, and it will be my first time ever published. So that's very exciting. I'm very happy about that. You know, 32 years I've been wanting to be published, and you know, through this medium, I'm actually able to do that. So like I said, the story is called Hope, and
is this the one that starts up on the plane with the dad?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Did you do the drawings?
So I didn't draw anything. The way that it works with comics is the writer will pretty much map out every single panel and kind of give a direction to the artist of what they're thinking. So the biggest problem, I'm going to kind of take a step back. The biggest problem I had writing this story was that I'm not Puerto Rican. I have been to Puerto Rico a few times, but I don't have a real pull there. I don't have a calling. And I realized as I was working actually on this anthology, I've learned so much about their culture and a lot of horrible things that have happened to them, especially through like Christopher Columbus. So it was a very big challenge for me to write a 10-page story about something that I don't really know and trying to find those emotions. And I looked to, like I said, Hurricane Sandy and trying to, how did I feel after that happened? Seeing my home destroyed by such a tragedy. And then also I used my dad as an influence as well. Not to give anything away, but the story does start with the father on a jetty saying, I have no words. And what words do you actually have when you see your home completely destroyed and going back and seeing your family like, yes, they survived. But from my dad, as I was saying, from his jetty growing up, he always said to me he wanted to take his son, he would dream as a young child to take his son to this jetty and have these words of wisdom and talk about life and everything. And I kind of started there with Sandy in mind and how he really felt if that jetty was taken away. And while the jetty wasn't taken away by my character, but again, it's just that emotion and trying to find that. And it was interesting. It was a really nice challenge, not writing something I know, and everything I have written to this point has been something that I kind of had real emotion and feeling toward. So this was a really interesting challenge to do.
Yeah, and so you started from that point and then went back. So when you submit the comic story, you give it to the artist, do you do what the dad and the son are saying, or you just create a narrative?
I wrote everything. I mapped out every single panel. I wrote word that they said, everything from colors, obviously, is up to the artist or the colorist. Fortunately, Ramon, who did my story, was able to draw ink, color, and also letter. There's a lot of steps in the comic book process.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot
of moving pieces. So fortunately, he was able to do all that. And you know, as a writer, it's very hard because you have an image in your head as you're writing that story, and you have to, write in such a way that the artist is able to interpret what you're saying. And he just nailed it. Like he got everything that I was looking for. And it just, again, it's powerful. I was really going for emotion, and one of the co-editors who read my story actually cried when he read it because he felt that emotion of his family, of going to see them like after like such a thing.
It was really, really powerful too. I thought the same
thing. Thank you.
Must tell folks how they can get a copy of this and also the ranking.
Sure. So very exciting. We were on Amazon under number one new releases for graphic novels anthologies. We have been actually jumping around even under historical, still in a graphic novel section, but it's insane to think that this has built up such momentum. We're all very excited because we want to give back as much as possible. So the fact that the word is actually getting out is just really wonderful, and it makes you feel good. And the best way to get that is either via Amazon. The anthology, once again, is called Puerto Rico Strong. And if you don't want to go to Amazon and you want to support your local comic book store, you can go and they will order it for you. And I would probably encourage that just because mom and pop.
Right.
You got to support the local business.
Yep.
Guess what I'm doing? Because...
Yeah. This is a little secret thing we're doing, maybe the audience won't notice.
Yes, the audience won't notice, but we're kind of moving along. It's a hat change. I like to do a hat change.
Now I'm gonna fix my necklace.
And what I'm saying is, we have to go to 2 hours.
You know what I loved about those two is that both of their stories was what they did was. From a personal experience, their heart. So,
it
wasn't
real.
Just to entertain. It was something.
No, it's from the heart. It's passion. It's emotion. It's feeling.
And
you could feel it.
Yeah, and
it's
I think that's what adds to the success of a lot of shows is that if it's coming from your heart, even experiences, even maybe just personal experiences, if you can base your story on that, there's so much more behind it.
What's really we did hours of planning for this, and you and hours and hours, and we're just not.
We're ready.
We have
a surprise change now.
Next up, we're with Brianna Eve and Josh Flitter.
Yes, welcome to the show.
Welcome. You know, all four of you with such diverse entertainment backgrounds, and it's so fascinating and so interesting. So I'm going to do a quick intro with Josh, a child prodigy. I guess I can say that.
An adult prodigy too.
I mean, you and there's a great connection with Josh and I because my wife, Fran, was your fourth grade teacher.
Yes, she was.
Mm-hmm. When you were doing a Disney movie, the greatest game ever played.
You got it.
I was thinking of something else here, but
greatest game ever told.
So you had an amazing background. So we're just gonna jump right in because
sure.
we want to. So, you take it away.
Yeah, well, I would like you to tell everybody, if they don't know who you are, what movies that they can see you in.
I did this movie called The Greatest Game Ever Played, which is this golf movie that starred Shia LaBeouf, and A License to Wed, which was with Robin Williams and John Krasinski and Mandy Moore, Nancy Drew, which is with Emma Roberts, Big Mama's House 2, Ace Ventura Jr., Pet Detective.
Love that one.
what else is there? There's a lot of these, they're called Air Buddies, Space Buddies, Snow Buddies. They're these little dogs. You know, they're on Netflix. Do the voice of this character, Butterball, that if you have, you know, little kids or younger siblings, they might love that. And, yeah, I think those are the major ones. My mom's probably going to be mad because I'll probably forget something.
I forgot one or two. Well, yeah. Everybody can look you up. Do you have a contact where people can find out who you are?
If you go on IMDb and you search my name, Josh Flitter, you'll find information there if you're
okay, great.
So inclined.
All right, so where are you now? That's where we want to kind of jump. No.
Okay.
Where are you now? Like, what are you doing now?
I'm currently living in New York City. I just graduated from the School of Visual Arts with a degree in directing and writing. Right now I'm auditioning for a lot of things, still pursuing acting. But I think the ultimate goal is to be kind of all of it, is to do all of it. Like, I love creating my own stories, and it's awesome to hear the guests that we have tonight. Everyone's really passionate about kind of the same thing. Telling your own stories, and whether they be something really personal or something funny. In my case, I like to tell, you know, goofy stories. But I think right now I'm really focusing on kind of making myself the best possible version of myself, where it's studying writing at Upright Citizens Brigade, taking sketch writing classes or improv classes. At the People's Improv Theater or Upright Citizens Brigade. Creating my own sketches, putting them on YouTube with my friends. Just kind of finding myself as an entertainer, as a comedic actor and writer.
That's all right, cool. That's a good place.
To give people a grasp of the depth and how you've been involved, you've interacted and you've been interviewed Jay Leno, Don, you've gone head to head with Don Rickles. And
none of which are as intimidating as you.
Really?
Yeah.
You're intimidated? Why? Because my wife is your teacher?
Yes. Why? Oh, my goodness. Oh. Yes, that's the hardest. Yeah.
Well, she's not a teacher anymore, so forget about it. But why don't you just kind of fill in a little bit on some of the fascinating interviews?
Sure, yeah. So after I did The Greatest Game Ever Played, I was asked to be on Jay Leno. And I was, I think, 10 or 11 or something. And I believe this was the time I was on twice. And no, but one of the times, Don Rickles was one of the guests. And it was really funny because I had no idea who he was. Because I was, you know, 11 years old.
Sure.
And my parents there, and my dad goes, "Oh my God, you know, that's Don Rickles. You got to go say hi. He's one of the most famous comedians of all time. And he'll roast you, you know. Tell him to call you a hockey puck." And like that, you know, that was this thing. I had no idea. And I walk up, I'm like, hey, Don, you know, you're a hockey puck, whatever. Like, I call, said it to him, and he just starts cracking me. He's like, you're Jewish. You have your bar mitzvah yet? You have your, like, he just started, like, roasting me like a little 12-year-old. And I had no idea. I was just kind of laughing. But I was like, who is this guy? And then finally my mom goes, oh, that's Mr. Potato Head from Toy Story. And I was like, oh. No. Like, that was, you know. But, yeah, that completely blew my mind then. But now, you know, he unfortunately passed away. I mean, but what a life that guy had. And then when I learned all about him, just studying comedy, it's amazing. I'm so grateful to have been able to meet him.
Yes.
And not even knowing, you know, at the time, people would kill to meet Don Rickles. And, you know, I was this, like, 12-year-old that had no idea, you know, who I was meeting. Yeah. But now, looking back at it, it's incredible.
Yeah. And, yeah. And Robin Williams, you have a memory of Robin Williams.
Yeah, I did a film with him called License to Wed. That was a comedy. It was with him and John Krasinski and Mandy Moore. But Robin was by far the greatest person I've ever met, worked with. Just the best. Everything that I strive to be as an actor, as an entertainer, as a person, is him. He would put... we did this movie for 2 months, and he would, every day, come in and ask me, you know, all my scenes were with him. I played kind of like his sidekick in the movie. And I'm 12 years old, and he's asking me, you know, how my family is every day, how Scott, my brother, how your dog's doing, you know, like just being super, he's just so nice to everyone. And he would disappear, and people would be like, oh God, where's Robin? He would be doing basically one-man stand-up shows for like the grips, like the guys who are the first ones there and the last ones to go home. And he's in between shots doing comedy bits for them. He just was the sweetest guy on the planet, and so funny, just so funny. Yeah, and
lucky to have met people like that, huh?
Yeah, he was unbelievable. I remember there was one thing, like, because he used to say to me that I was like, you know, oh, you're able to keep up with me. It's unbelievable. And I was, you know, 12, and he would walk around like doing these like fart jokes, you know, because I was 12. He'd just be like, just like kind of like pooping his pants. Mm-hmm. But then we like started doing this bit where like we were both dogs, like, and we would fart and be like, oh, what'd you have for dinner? And I'd be like, oh, you had tuna fish. You know, we were like just going back and forth.
Wow.
And, you know, just being a little kid, and I knew who Robin Williams was. You know, he's unbelievable. But being able to have those experiences with him, any improv abilities that I have now, you know, they all come from just a crash course with Robin Williams. Before a shot, he would be like, you know, be ready. And I would say, okay. And he would just start improvising and like just hoping that I would keep up with him. And I would do my best, and he thought it was pretty good. But to me, like, I was thrown into just a pit with wolves, the nicest wolf in the world.
Right.
But still, like, that's, you know.
Yeah.
It was unbelievable.
That quickly, a dream project. Do you have a dream project?
To create my own kind of, nothing specific, but to create my own universe, comedy universe, like Austin Powers kind of thing.
Okay.
Something that you could do a few movies with the same kind of crazy character.
Okay.
Cool. Yeah. I have one more question with him.
Go ahead.
I don't want to say it as like a bad thing, because I don't think it's a child star to what you are now. You were a big child star, and then you're not doing as much now. There's a transition you must have went through.
Yeah, there was.
Yeah. But was it age that changed things for you, or did you take a break and then coming back into it now, is it harder?
No. Yeah. It's interesting. I think what kind of made the big
transition.
Kind of pause transition happened was both good and bad. It was positive and negative, because I stayed here in Marlboro, where I'm from, and my parents never wanted me to be like a Hollywood kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I have all these people who I know that are out there that are still working and kind of worked through that, but they're a little, you know, not totally normal. Mm-hmm. I mean, none of us are normal, but they have been too exposed to this world, which is very fake and very scary, and to be able to have a normal childhood in between doing these movies and coming home and going to regular public school kept me to be being a normal person. But at the same time, I think it hindered my chances of maybe going out on things. You know, I stayed acting the whole time and auditioned, but I think it kept me out of the limelight.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and now getting back in, is a different
Yeah, it's tougher now because there's so many mediums. There's so many, you know, there's people are becoming Vine stars and then or Instagram stars or YouTube or TV or now there's Netflix and movies, you know, rather than just TV and movies. That was kind of, or theater. Those were like the three.
Right.
And now there's so many different ways. People are getting famous overnight and starting to become somebody overnight that it's almost tougher. There's so many different ways. It's like, what do I throw all of myself at?
Yeah. No, I always say it's like oversaturated.
Yeah.
You know, it's not that whole big name anymore. If you can just be happy with doing what you love to do and being good at it, that maybe is the only
Absolutely.
Goal you should go for. Okay. So should we hit the next one?
Yes, we do. Brianna Eve time.
Brianna Eve.
Yes. So I'm going to do the intro.
Yes.
Brianna Eve, I've known for 7 years and I've watched you grow up.
And
I've watched you, and you're going to talk about your background, but I mean, you're an aspiring actress, accomplished. You're a singer, a performer. And for a while, you on iTunes, you had the number one, Like a Rose. I mean, you're so accomplished, so diverse. You've got such an amazing background, both from Marlboro.
Yeah.
So there's something about the water here. Actually, three.
Seriously.
I just realized there's three
the
of you
from Marlboro.
One, two, three. John, too bad. That's the way it goes. Three from Marlboro. We could have called this Marlboro. So, Brianna Eve, welcome.
Thank you.
Why don't you give us a little bit of a background, education, and we...
Yeah. Where do I even start? I went to Red Bank Catholic High School, so I did live in Marlboro, but I moved over to Red Bank Catholic because they had a really great performing arts program. And I had incredible experiences in doing just some musicals and getting my feet in the water and figuring out, you know, what kind of stuff I love to do. But they also gave me opportunities to do these musicals, and then I did, which they gave me nominations for. So like the Count Basie, the Basie Awards, I had nominated for Basie Awards, and then Paper Mill Playhouse, which Anne Hathaway was nominated for a few years ago, years before she got big. I was nominated for two as well. So just like opportunities like that. And then I loved performing and I decided to go to college for it. So then I went to Rutgers and did Mason Gross, got into Mason Gross for classical performing, vocal performance, and traveled to London, did study there for a little bit, voice, and then now I graduated in May. So now I'm here.
And somewhere in there, didn't you do Off-Broadway in New York City?
Yes. So in high school, I decided to audition for this Off-Broadway original musical called Broadway Jane. And it was a crazy audition. I was young. I think it was a sophomore in high school, and it was intimidating. But, yeah, I got the lead in the Off-Broadway show. It performed... Performances were in Middletown as well as New York City, which is pretty much all summer. I had to stay in an apartment in the summer and just go to the performances, which is really cool.
I know when we were talking about your path and your journey through, you know, where you are now and what you've been doing this summer, you can talk about that too, but you always wanted to take a step forward.
Yeah.
Tell us about
that. No, that was the biggest thing for me. So growing up in Marlboro, you know, I didn't get some of the roles that I really wished that I could, so I traveled and went to Red Bank. And Red Bank, I had incredible opportunities. But in Red Bank, I didn't just stay in Red Bank. I also went to Homedale, and I did productions in Homedale as well as Eatontown, and then New York. Then I did the Off-Broadway show in New York. And then I went to Rutgers and did some performances there. And then after Rutgers, I mean, I just got back from a contract in Virginia. So I went to Virginia, and I was in Busch Gardens, the performance down there called Gloria. So I did that. So like we were saying before.
What got you to Virginia?
Yeah, so the steps.
Tell about
so
that.
Everything's about this. I honestly think it's all about, like, I like to keep moving forward, keep going. So I graduated, and just not turning back, I went to New York, did actually a workshop with Bob Klein, which is an incredible casting director. Just finding an opportunity that maybe he could get my foot in the door kind of thing. And after I think it was like a 2-month workshop, I saw an audition online and I said, Bob, I emailed the audition first. And he said, Brianna actually I see that you auditioned. You applied for this audition. And I said, yeah, you know, I'd love to do it. And, you know, I saw your name was on it. Maybe you could, you know, set me up like an audition thing. And he said, yeah, you're in. And I said, okay, great. So I show up to this audition, which, not knowing, it was the callback. So a few weeks before, they had auditions for like 300 girls were there. So they had cut down to 36, around like 30, 40 girls at this callback. So I had at 10 o'clock, I had my audition for the callback. So they said, okay, do we like you, do we not like you, sing. And they liked me, so I stayed the next half hour for the callback. And that was with the 30 girls in the room, and sang my song, and then I left. But yeah, it was crazy because I didn't have to go to the crazy audition. I was able to get a little foot in the door just by Bob Klein. So and then I got the call a few weeks. Actually, it was about a month later, and then I went to Virginia for 2 months. Yeah.
There's a segue, and it fascinates me that what you had to do with your voice.
Yeah.
And to prepare, because what you did with your voice and to preserve your voice, because you had to use your voice. Talk about that.
Yeah.
I mean,
yes.
Like 6 times a day for 17 straight days?
Yeah, so 6 shows a day, about 4 to 6 shows a day for 17 days straight. And then we had one break, Christmas, and then we had the next.
It's called Gloria, and you played
The Virgin Mary.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It was kind of like a musical. They just like put just like a... all the Christmas songs, like not all, but a bunch of Christmas songs together and made kind of a musical. That's really cool. So preserving my voice. Well, I have classical training, so just breathing techniques have helped me just immensely, just because it's not straining any parts of your throat, just with your diaphragm. But I had to learn how to figure out how to keep my voice preserved, because you're singing constantly. I mean, I got there at 1 o'clock and didn't leave till 10.
Wow.
And you were singing the whole day. So I actually got a steam inhaler, just like a big steam inhaler, and I would breathe into it like before every performance, just warming up the vocal cords, keeping them healthy. And then I would do a neti pot every morning, which is like pouring water through your nose out the other
end.
Kind of gross. No.
No,
kind of gross. But just like clearing your sinuses out, clearing all the germs out, just because you're trying not to get sick. Because the biggest thing is when you start to get sick, that's when you just got to be careful. So that's when I would gargle with salt water. There's like just special gargles that you're supposed to do with salt water, honey, and baking powder that you just throw in together, and it's just like a treatment for your throat.
I have to talk to you about this because I've talked for like 10 minutes today and I've lost my voice already.
It's hard, and I had to figure it out, and I was thrown right into the fire, but I was able to sing every song, every show, and it was great. I mean, I had an understudy, but you know, whenever I needed her, she'd go in. And
that's just great.
I know, it was incredible. I learned a lot. It was an incredible experience, and I've taken so much from it. So I'm excited to be back, excited to audition season. Which we're excited for.
Yeah.
So we were talking before.
Okay.
Now you did the you've sang in Asbury, you've sang on at the Strand Theater, you've as a singer, and you've done the theater, the off Broadway, you've done the community theater, the local stuff, and you've done in Virginia, and you've done in Busch Gardens and stuff like this. But the fun thing, which has to do with you, was when you said you wanted to go start to get to central casting and to go into the city and do background work, and I was like, she asked me her advice, and I said, you know, I did the whole acting thing too when in my 20s, and I said, why would you want to do the background? You know, just go for the big roles. And you were like, okay, and then you let that go for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then you came back to me, and what'd you say?
Well, I said that I wanted it to be a learning experience. I said that I think I have no idea behind the background of film. I don't know the technical words for things, or, you know, how it cuts and you have to completely go back and do the same. I just have no idea. So I'm like, in college I did opera. I didn't do scene work. I mean, I did intense acting classes, but I didn't do scene work. So I was like, okay, I have to learn what's going on if I ever want to be in a film, which I definitely would love to be. And Central Casting actually gave me an opportunity to be in a Woody Allen film with Selena Gomez. And which is incredible. I know, I'm so excited. Coming out 2019.
Right. But that's
so I'll just be walking past.
It's the same kind of thing. How
but just learning.
You want to learn every part of it.
You know,
the directing, background, the lighting, the tech work. That's really the whole encompasses everything. It makes you smarter.
It just helps you. Yeah. It just educates you. And that's why. That's why I do what I do, so.
Yeah. Are we changing hats?
We're changing hats.
We need more time.
It's a little bit of a cue. Well, there, you
that's
know,
the cue.
I get so frustrated because we work
nobody
for...
Nobody understands the hat thing.
Well,
do
the hat is a cue.
The, end
the hat is a cue, and we're going to do a little bit of a group session.
There's all sorts of
we're
things
gonna
happening
have some fun
behind the scenes right now.
So we're going to jump right into this because we're ready to roll. Okay, so,
okay.
And I've been pitching this to you guys that we're going to ask some interesting questions.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to ask the first.
Oh, I'm waiting.
I'm going to ask the first, and you can start and just go around. Someone living or dead you'd love to have dinner with? These are one word answers, so we can move
or
along.
Or dead.
Living
that's
or dead?
Key.
Dinner.
You start.
Okay.
Living or dead? I think, honestly, maybe Princess Diana.
Oh.
Okay. Like I just
that.
Think she's elegant and poised.
Like
I'd love to meet her and have dinner.
Chris Farley. I would love to just laugh the entire time.
Okay. Neil.
I'm actually going to go a completely different route than everyone else, and I'm probably going to say my grandfather. I would love to have one last dinner with him before he passed away.
Come on, man.
I know,
yeah,
right?
That was
I'm
good.
Sorry.
Come on.
That was good.
I'm going to stick with my guns. Bernard King. He's still alive, but I patterned my whole game.
Okay.
He was my true hero when I was a kid. You know. So
and you're a player.
I'm a basketball player.
You're a basketball
player.
Player.
And I still carry Bernard's jersey in my basketball bag to this day.
You're up. Let's move
okay,
this.
These are so tough. I feel so bad for you guys.
No.
Okay. Best time and worst time of your life. You don't have to explain it all as much as you just have to lay it out.
Mine was the best time and the worst time at the same time.
Okay.
Going through the ages of like 10 to 15 because it was working, but it was also just puberty, which is just the worst. But yeah.
It was the best.
I think the worst time probably would be the car accident. I was in a head-on collision. Mm. I was out for a few years. And then the best time would be, honestly, this Virginia experience, because it was a professional experience, and I learned a lot from it and took a lot of incredible experiences from it, yeah.
Awesome.
My best time was probably, actually, definitely marrying my wife, Delilah. Hi, Delilah.
Aww. Aww.
That's sweet.
You should go last.
Yeah.
You should go last.
And then worst time.
You got
time,
points for that one.
Yeah. And then worst time, I'm gonna pass on that one because I don't know what the worst time was.
The best time, I always say, was the game six of the World Series in 1986 when the Mets won.
Let's go! I wasn't born yet, but I'm a Mets fan.
A transcendent moment.
Okay.
Now, obviously, the birth of my daughter, and my son. But and the worst time was a bad time. I had a Mardi Gras, which I can't really talk about.
Okay. Next, before I leave this earth, I won't be satisfied until I blank.
Write, direct, and star in a movie. That yeah.
Okay.
It's actually a quote from Beyonce's song, "Till I Leave My Footprints in the Sands of Time." I just want to leave my footprint
very nice.
Here.
Mm-hmm. Neil,
I'm going to go to John.
John,
see this horror film get made. See this horror film get made.
Okay, wonderful.
I'm actually going to kind of echo that because we were talking about this before. But I would love to write a horror comic that I'm already.
Oh, wow. So you guys can work together,
and we'll start it.
Yeah,
we made a match. We made a match tonight, and guess what? We're just about
that's
out of time.
It.
He's knocking on the window there.
That's
the
wonderful.
Invisible man.
So we want to thank everybody.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. And
I wish we had at least another hour or two with you guys because there's just so much. And maybe we can do this again because we can do whatever we want, right?
Yes. And we want.
Yeah, we can.
I'm taking my shoes off.
Take shoes off.
Everybody go to the website, njdiscover.com. Read the article about this. You can find out the people's name, their contact, how to reach them, how to see what they're doing and follow them. So that's important.
In the immortal words, since you guys are horror things here, in the immortal words of Arnold Schwarzenegger, we'll be back.
We'll be back.
Huh?
You know, bye, everybody.
The Terminator?
Yes.
We'll be back. We will be back.
Yes.
So we're just about out of time.
Thank
I wish we had more. Thank you guys for being
thank
here.
You guys
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank
it's
you.
Been
yeah.
wonderful.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining
right.
us tonight.
Okay. Awesome. Yeah,